Hello, good evening everyone. Welcome to the Friday Bible study. We are taking a break next week, so this will be the Friday's Bible study for this week, and next week we will not have, and the week after we will resume. So let's pray and start. Precious Lord, we want to thank you for giving us this privilege to come to your feet, to sit at your feet and learn truths that are going to set us free. Thank you for every son and daughter who have joined and who will join, that their lives are going to be transformed by the revelation and the truth that you're going to bring this day. Holy Spirit, thank you for being here to teach us. We are so grateful to you. We are surrendered, submitted to your authority and lordship, and we are yielded. Transform our minds by the renewing of our minds through the truth that you reveal today. In Jesus' mighty name we pray, and everyone say amen. So once again, next week we will not have the Bible study, the Wednesday as well as Friday Bible study. I'm taking a break, and the week after we will resume both the Wednesday and the Friday Bible study. Thank you so much for being a part of this study and being so thirsty and hungry for the truth. Okay, today part four, spiritual undercover, part four. Last week, we ended with under whose spiritual covering you are coming. It's a great concern. Am I right? I explained to you last week. So let's move on this week. Now we are parked ourselves with the life of Job, and we are studying, and we saw the primary fundamental spiritual undercover that we could see from Job's life is that he was a blameless, upright, fearing God and shunning evil. It was a undercover. Being righteous, walking upright before God itself is a spiritual undercover. You know, we saw that. So now, which hedge? Now we saw there are three dimensional hedge that was around Job. Number one, the Job that was the hedge that was around Job. Number two, the hedge around his household. Number three, the hedge that was around his possessions. So it was a three dimensional hedge simply because of the result of Job walking upright, blameless, fearing God and shunning evil. Okay, so now which edge Satan is promoting to remove? Okay, so Satan is suggesting, okay, God, you remove this hedge, and we'll see how the reaction of Job is going to be. Which hedge is Satan promoting to be removed? Any guesses? Let's go to Job chapter 1 verse 11. Job chapter 1 verse 11 is where we're going to start. I hope that your Bibles are ready and your pen and book. But now stretch out your hand and strike everything he has, and he will surely curse you to your face. So which edge is Satan promoting to be removed? The third hedge, am I right? The first hedge is that is around Job. Second hedge is that is around his household. And third hedge is the possession. So Satan is saying to God, okay, remove the third hedge of possessions. Now stretch out your hand and strike everything he has, his possessions, and he will surely curse you to your face. So he's promoting the third hedge. Okay, so verse 12, if you see God's response, the Lord said to Satan, very well, then everything he has is in your power. So God is removing the hedge, the third hedge. but on the man himself do not lay a finger. Then Satan went out from the presence of God. So now you see, God has given permission. God has removed the second edge also. So everything, yes, is in your power, but on the man himself do not lay a finger. Okay. Shall we go to KJV, Sean? That would be a little better translation. I will show you something. And the Lord said unto Satan, behold, all that he hath is in thy power, only upon himself put not forth thine hand. So Satan went forth from the presence of the Lord. So God is saying, I'm removing this. You asked for the third hedge, but I'm removing the second hedge also. But you cannot touch Job. Okay. Are you seeing what I'm seeing? So, I want to show you something very critical. Something very critical here. Okay. Did you notice Satan had to get approval before he went on this mission? We need to see why. Okay. Satan had to get approval before he went on his mission. So this is why I said Satan was summoned for this meeting, I believe, because he has no rights, no authority to barge into heaven to a meeting that God is conducting with sons of God, the angels. He has no authority. He cannot get crash. So I strongly believe the Lord summoned Satan to brag about his son Job. So we got to see something here, something very critical. That is he had to get approval before he went on this mission of launching attack on Job. So let's turn our Bibles to 1 Corinthians chapter 10. I hope that you're receiving. We need to see something here. 1 Corinthians chapter 10. verse 11 to 13. Okay, you need to learn something from here. Okay, and it says, these things happened to them as examples and were written down as warnings for us, on whom the culmination of the ages has come. So Paul is writing to the Corinthian church and he's telling, look here, guys, whatever that is written in the Old Testament about people, places and incidents and occurrences, events that happen in the lives of the Old Testament saints, they are written as examples and were written down as warnings for us, on whom the culmination of the ages has come. So whatever written about Job and what happened to him and what did Satan do, how he did things, is an example. They are written down as examples as well as warnings for us. Okay? So this is why reading Old Testament is very important. You can learn a lot of lessons. You can find a lot of hidden secrets. Now, some promote saying, no, we are not of the old covenant. We don't need to read Old Testament. We as New Testament believers, what belongs to us is the epistles. And 1 John, 2 John, 1 Peter, 2 Peter, 3 John, Jude and Revelation, these all belongs to the church. Old Testament is unnecessary. Some say that. But Paul says to the Corinthian church, whatever that is written, and these things that happened to them as examples and were written down as warnings for us, on whom the culmination. So when you read these things, you learn. because they are examples for us, and it's a warning on us. Okay, and so it says, so if you think you are standing firm, be careful. So if you think you are standing firm, be careful that you don't fall. Verse 13, no temptation has overtaken you except what is common to mankind. So whatever temptation that has come your way and my way is not something very strange. It is common. Somebody has gone through it before. Somebody has been tempted by this temptation before. Nothing is uncommon. Every temptations that we go through are temptations that somebody has gone through it already. No temptation has overtaken you except what is common to mankind. And God is faithful. He will not let you be tempted beyond what you can bear. But when you are tempted, He will also provide a way out so that you can endure it. So, precious children of God, the word temptation is another word, is trials. Okay? When trials comes your way, don't think you're the only one who's going through this trial. Pastor, well, I'm the only one suffering like this, Pastor. No, somebody has suffered this before. Okay? There is no uncommon temptation. All temptation are common because somebody has gone through it. Whatever temptation that you are going, trial that you're going through, Jesus has already gone through it as a man. Okay? So, one thing that we need to understand is, when God allows Satan to put you on trial, God will not bring trials. God will give permission for devil to bring trials, like Job. Okay? So when those trial comes, they will not be, the trial will not be bigger than your capacity. Look, He will not let you be tempted beyond what you can bear. So when God permits Satan to put me on trial, God will not send a trial that is beyond my capacity. That's number one. Number two is, in the midst of the trial, God will also provide a way out. How to get out of the trial so that you can endure it. Did you see what I'm saying? So, whatever happened in the Old Testament, they are written for our example and warnings. The Old Testament saints also went through trials. Trials come your way because God permits Satan to put you on test. Okay? So when God puts you on test, he will not allow the devil to test you beyond your capacity. And also, in the midst of the trial, the Lord will show you a way out to endure the trial. Okay? So, Job, the Lord permitted Satan to put on trial, to put on a test. It was a test for Job. If you have walked, let me say this to you. If you have walked blameless, upright, righteous, fearing God, shunning evil, you have walked upright before God, righteous before God, and if you're going through certain struggles, trials, if you're going through certain tests that you're going through, know that a promotion is coming ahead. Because God is testing you. Through Satan, God does not test you, God does not tempt you, God uses Satan to test you and see whether you have the endurance. Okay? So, this is what Job was going through. God bragged about Job. And Satan said, because you have blessed him, anybody can, you know, say, bless the Lord, oh my soul. And they can sing till the sun goes down. But if you put him to test, watch and see how he's going to curse you. God said, okay, deal, man. Let's try and see. And Job passed the test. But one thing that we need to tell is that God will not allow you to be tested beyond your capacity. Always God will show you a way out so that you can endure the test. Did you get that? So I want you to notice that God is like a referee. Okay? God is like a referee who regulates the temptation or the trials so that he has control. So when devil brings test on us as the children of God, when we are walking upright, blameless, righteous, shunning evil, fearing God, when you're walking with God, when the trial comes, the Lord is like a referee. He will watch when temptation or trials comes into your space. God will say, hey, Satan, this is your limit. Beyond this, no, you can't. Sean, this is the limit you can test him. Beyond this, no. I'm drawing the line. So if the moment the devil tried to step the line, come back, you know. So God is like a referee. God is supreme, precious children of God. He is the ultimate authority. There is no one who can, you know, go beyond these instructions. So devil, even though he has no authority to touch a child of God, he has no capacity and the power to touch a child of God because of the hedge. But there are times that the Lord will permit test trials into our life to prove our maturity, to prove our capacity so that he can promote us. You know, without test, you don't get promoted. Am I right? Grade one, at the term end, you have a test. The third term, you have a test. If you don't pass the test, you are still in grade one. Why? Because tests prove your capacity, your maturity. So test and trials, God allows Satan to bring it into our lives so that we can prove our maturity and position ourselves for a promotion. Are you with me? So God is like a referee. The devil cannot go beyond God. He knows your limit and he will not allow anything to come beyond your limit. So if you're going through trials or a testing period and you have walked righteous before God, you have shunned evil, you walked in fear of God, and still there are certain struggles or tests have come your way, endure it. And nothing is beyond your capacity. You can handle it because God will not allow anything to come beyond your capacity. You can handle it, precious child of God. Some of you are feeling, oh, this is beyond me. I can't endure it anymore. No, God will never permit any trial to come your way beyond your capacity. But listen to this. If you have been living an unrighteous life, okay, you're blamed before God. You are not upright before God. You don't have the fear of the Lord. You embrace evil. Then whatever comes on you is not permitted by God. You have invited it. You have opened the doors and asked the devil, let's come, let's play. Let's play together. And when the fellows start to play together, he knows only three things: steal, kill, and destroy. So his game is stealing, killing, and destroying. So now you are in a game with the devil because you opened the door. That God can't help, precious child of God. Unless you repent, ask forgiveness, and then shut the door. Okay? But if you walk righteous, blameless, upright, fearing God, the Lord, there are times he will permit Satan, like in Job's life, saying, okay, I'll give you permission. I'll remove the hedge. Test my son and see, because I am positioning him for a promotion. Are you with me? So precious child of God, God knows your capacity. God knows what you can handle and what you cannot handle. He knows. But I would say, Job, my goodness, this man had such a capacity. Because within a day, precious child of God, excuse me, you're watching us from Sri Lanka. I hope that you're really enjoying the heat in Colombo. I'm, of course, really enjoying it. So now Job, within a day, he lost all his wealth, everything, precious child of God. He lost all his servants. He lost his children. And I look at his capacity and I salute him. I salute him. What a capacity this man. If I were Job, I would have said, Matanamba, Ammo, this I can't handle it, God. You know, so the temptation that comes your way, listen to me, the temptation or the trials rather that comes your way is a revelation of your capacity. Did you hear me? The trials that you're going through, because of walking upright, blameless and righteous before God, the trials that comes your way is a revelation of your capacity. Some, if they get a small fever, they are knocked off. That's their capacity. They renounce God, they spit on God's face and they'll say, what is this, man? There is God. I don't want to go to church. I will never read the Bible. God is a myth, and I don't believe in this. Body fever, they will do that. Why? That's their capacity. But some may go through a severe, fatal accident, and then illness, or maybe a financial loss. And they still stand and say, no, I believe the Lord is going to bring me out. It's a revelation of your capacity. I worship God no matter whatever happens. Even everything I lose, I will worship God. That's the revelation of your capacity. Someone loses a job. Who is Jesus, man? Is he God? I don't believe in him. I never come to church here after. Tell Pastor Raj, I will not cite the church. That's their capacity. You get what I'm saying. So you're trials will prove or reveal your capacity. It will reveal your capacity to God. But the trial that God permitted to you, God knows you can handle it, but you didn't have the maturity to handle it. But you had the capacity to handle it, because God never permits anything beyond your capacity. I hope that you are getting. So precious child of God, whenever things are thrown at you, it is a powerful picture of your inner spiritual capacity. Now, when Jesus took the disciples and he said, let's go to the other side, okay, what Jesus was trying to prove is the capacity of the disciples. So he never told them about the storm. So Jesus went to the lower deck and he had a good snooze, good sleep. When the storm came, the capacity of the disciples were revealed. Why are you so fearful? Is this all the capacity that you have? Jesus was asking them. So precious children of God, when trials are thrown at you, it is a powerful picture of your inner spiritual capacity. The reaction that you show is a powerful picture of your inner spiritual capacity. Somebody going through a headache will bring the whole roof down. But whereas in the same room, somebody is going through a cancer, but they are so calm and they are worshiping God. They are focused on the word. They are not bringing the roof down. They are so calm, collective, solid. They are steadfast in the Lord. But the person seated next to him is having a headache and brought the roof down. That shows the picture of their spiritual capacity. The Lord will look at the person who had headache and brought the roof down. Promotion occur, postponed. The other person, yes, you have positioned yourself for a promotion. Are you with me, precious child of God? So when Satan comes, he has to come with enough resources to defeat you. Okay? Now when God says, okay, I will give permission for you to test or put a trial on Rajah. So the Satan has to come with enough resources to knock me off. But if he doesn't, if my capacity is greater than his trial, I have positioned myself for the promotion. Are you with me? Look at Job. When he finished, he have everything double except for the wife. Okay? Look at Joseph. Joseph went through so much of trials. At the end of the trial, you know, he was sold as a slave to Egypt. You know, when they bring slaves to Egypt in those days, they don't bring the man with, you know, Levi's denim and a nice t-shirt and all of that. They bring the man naked. So when they brought Joseph to Egypt, to the slave trade market, they bring him naked because the man who's going to buy Joseph as a slave, he will see for any defects in his body. So they are brought naked. He came naked. You know, Joseph is also a picture of Jesus in the Old Testament. So when this Potiphar bought, so this man would have become a broken man. My own brothers have betrayed me and sold me for money. And I'm a naked man standing in front of so many people, humiliated. And then Potiphar buys him and takes him home. And then there he's falsely accused, because Potiphar's wife wanted to sleep with Joseph. And you know the words of Joseph? He didn't say, how can I sin against you or your master? He said, how can I sin against my Lord? See the capacity of this man. And then from there, falsely accused and goes to the prison. In prison, he didn't curse God. He was the best prisoner. See the capacity of this man. And the Lord said, Joseph, you have passed the test. You have passed the trial. I'm promoting you to the prime minister's seat. Precious people of God, in the kingdom of God, I would rather say it's not your fasting, it's not your everyday Bible reading. All of these are good, huh? Actually, fasting, Bible reading, praying builds your capacity. But where you prove yourself for promotion is during trials. Your meditation of the Word of God, your fasting and prayer, your going to church, your serving in church, all of that builds your capacity for the day of trial. And when the day of trial comes, you will prove your capacity for promotion. You know, have you seen the scripture that says there are different kinds of vessels in the house of God? There is gold vessel, there is silver, there is bronze, there is wood. Why a vessel is called gold vessel? Because it has gone through fire and endured the test of fire. Why a vessel is called wood? Because it cannot go through fire. Podi fire kadakam amba, and God says, okay, please be a wood vessel. I will never send fire and trial towards you. Then You know, this is why some are promoted in the kingdom, precious children of God. Why they are promoted to the highest places is because they have gone through trials and proved their capacity to God. Amen. Jesus went through trials. And the final trial before the cross, my goodness, is the sweat turned into blood. Such was the intensity of the trial. And after the cross, God said, for God so highly exalted, far above principalities and powers, and given him a name that is above all other name. Why? He proved his capacity as a man. Are you with me, precious child of God? Samson, Naagatta. He had the anointing, physical power, but no internal capacity. He failed his test. Solomon the king, full of wisdom. There was no man like him. Such wisdom, but Naagatta. And he couldn't prove his capacity. Are you with me, precious children of God? I'm little diverting to show you something here because Job's story came here. Okay? So God has put a hedge around us. The devil cannot touch without the approval of God. But God will permit certain times for devil to touch you so that he can prove your capacity. He will remove hedges and say, okay, test my son, test my daughter. I give you permission to test. I will not test them. I will give you permission to test to prove their capacity. So all your years and times of fasting and prayer, Bible reading, meditation of the Bible, Wednesday Bible study, Friday Bible study, Sunday sermon, and LTP, okkam ekathu kala, on the day of trial, you need to prove yourself, prove your capacity, prove your maturity. The depth Job had in God was revealed when things were taken out of his life. The depth that Job had in God was proved when things were taken out of his life. He was still tuned to God. You know, if your relationship with God is adversely affected because things you possess are taken out of your life, then you have no depth. Then you don't have capacity. You have a very shallow relationship with God. You know, how many very shallow Christians I have seen in church? They just fall out with God. They don't come to church because they have gone through trials. They're angry with God now. They're angry with the pastor. They're angry with the church. Very shallow relationship. No depth in God. No capacity. In fact, trials are needed to reveal our status, precious child of God. End of the day, Satan is working for God, I would say. Yes, end of the day, Satan is working for God. God says, okay, now I'm using you to test my son. So God uses Satan to tempt us according to our capacity or send trial towards us. Why I brought this is, yes, hedge is very important, but there are times that the Lord will remove the hedge and put a trial on your path to prove your status, your capacity. So trials are good. You can prove your capacity and position yourself for promotion. So that's why when I pray, I say, I don't pray, Lord, please don't send any storms. I don't pray like that. Lord, make me so strong on the inside so that I can endure anything that comes my way, so that I can face and still stand and love you and continue to love you no matter whatever comes my way. Make me so strong on the inside. That's the prayer that I pray. I don't pray, Lord, don't please send any problem. Lord, never will I, don't, I never want, I want to see any problems. Please keep problems far away. No, I don't pray like that. Because I want promotions. Amen. So, you know, when I came into ministry, the first 2 years, precious child of God, it was attack after attack. And God was absolutely silent. I couldn't understand God. You know, there are moments I felt to quit the ministry and go back to work. And Satan also, created the pathway. So I was at the most desperate place, and I was at the end of the rope. My boss was calling from me, from the bank, and he's saying, you know, Solomon, they used to call me Sola at bank. I have got promoted as the, operation head of the region. Why don't you come? I'll give you a better offer. So Satan also creating a pathway, and I'm at the end of the rope, frustrated with God because he's not saying anything. So God must have watched, let's see whether this fellow can prove his capacity. So first 2 years when I stepped into full-time ministry, it was hell or high water. It was, I didn't know whether I was standing or sitting. But I was thinking, I'm doing everything right before God. I have stepped into full-time ministry as he called me. And I walked blameless, upright, righteous, fearing him. What is happening? I didn't understand this, what I'm teaching you right now, precious children of God. I learned it by experience. So when I proved myself, the promotion came. So if God wants to fast track your promotion, he will permit Satan to draw his attention towards you. So if God wants to promote himself, sometimes he will draw the attention of Satan. Have you considered my son Itzhar? You are right. Trials. So God, if you want to fast track your promotion, he will send trials your way. You know, trials leads you to patience. If you endure trials, that will lead you to word character. Character in another translation is patience. And when you prove your patience before God, that is maturity to God. How does God know that Sean is matured? When he shows patience during trial times. How does God know that Rajah is matured? When he is patient during trial times. Endurance, that is called endurance. You prove your character before God. So in a way, God uses Satan to promote us. In other words saying, sometimes you cannot be promoted without Satan. Satan will be the facilitator for you to be promoted by how God will send him to test you. And he will remove the hedge and say, okay, I give you permission. I hope that you're with me. Let's go to 1 Corinthians chapter 10 verse 13 again. It says, no temptation has overtaken you except that is common to mankind. And God is faithful, and he will not let you be tempted beyond what you can bear. But when you are tempted, he will also provide a way out so that you can endure it. So number one, God will regulate your trials. This one, Satan, you cannot. This one, Sean cannot handle. So you can't test him with that. This one, he can. So I give you permission to test him. This one, Insta, he can't. You cannot test him with this. But that one, yes, I give you permission. God will regulate your trials, number one. Number two, and he will give you wisdom to escape it also. Provided you don't lose your alignment with God. So when you're going through a trial, the Lord will show you a way out so that you can endure it. Are you with me? That is wisdom. God will give you wisdom to endure it. So these are two things that can happen in a child of God's life. Because now when I'm talking about hedge, sometimes you might have this question. That's what I brought this in. I walk right before God. I'm doing my best to be holy and righteous before God. And pastor is talking about the hedge. And the, so why this thing is happening to me? How come this thing happened to me? Because if I'm walking righteous, blameless, shunning evil, fearing God, why am I going through this? You might have had a question like that. So that's why I had to explain this to you. Yes, there are hedges. Yes, Satan has a calendar for every mankind. So when he comes, when you're undercover, he cannot touch you. But being under, so when you are doing everything right before God, you are undercover. But there are times the Lord takes off the undercover and says, I give you permission, Satan, to test, but to bring trial to my son to prove his capacity. I hope that you understood it. Okay? All right. So what we are looking at is the undercover. We diverted a little bit to answer a question which some of you might have had. So personal holiness is a primary undercover. Am I right? We saw that. Now let's go to Matthew chapter 18. Matthew chapter 18, verse 18 to 20. I hope that you're with me. Matthew chapter 18, verse 18 to 20. Okay. Truly I tell you, whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. So when I keep meditating this verse, now I'm meditating this for the kingdom. Peace. Am I right? We studied this. So some other revelation comes, which I might connect with another study. So I was able to connect it here also, because there's a revelation in it. Okay. Then verse 19. Again, truly I tell you that if two of you on earth agree about anything they ask for, it will be done for them by my Father in heaven. And verse 20. For where two or three gather in my name, there am I with them. Okay? Now, precious people of God, so when you read this scripture, it says, truly I tell you, whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth, it will be loosed in heaven. And then it says, truly I tell you, if two of you on earth agree about anything they ask, it will be done. So it's talking about individual scope of authority and corporate scope of authority. Okay? If you operate by faith. So the verse 20 explains how verse 19 is possible. Okay, so the verse 20 is the key behind verse 19. So what verse 19 says? Again, truly I tell you that if two of you on earth agree about anything they ask for, it will be done for them by my Father in heaven. So it's corporate. Okay, it's not individual. I tell you, if two of you on earth agree about anything they ask for, it will be done for them by my Father in heaven. Now watch, I'm going to teach you something very, very, very important. Okay, we have to go step by step to reveal what I'm going to teach you. I have another 15 minutes more, Sean. 15 minutes. Okay. Okay. So Paul is saying to the, Jesus is saying to the people, is saying, if two of you agree on earth about anything they ask for, it will be done for them by the Father in heaven. Okay. And verse 20, for where two or three gather in my name, there I am with them. Okay, so it's Jesus talking about a corporate scope of authority. Okay, a corporate scope of authority, and it is talking about a corporate covering. Okay, I want you to see that. There is an authority. It's an undercover. Okay, I want you to see that. So if you, precious child of God, if you study the Old Testament or New Testament, two or three is a number for witness. Okay? It's a quorum for witness. Two or three. Even in the New Testament, if somebody in the church brings an accusation. So now, for example, if somebody brings an accusation about an elder in the Father's house, I will always tell them, bring me two or three witnesses. Then I will inquire it. If not, I'm not going to inquire it. Because that's the quorum for witness, you know, to investigate. So two or three, it's corporate. It's a body structure. Okay? It's a body structure, the body of Christ. So it's to establish a matter, you need at least two or three witnesses, the kingdom. So that's why you see Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, they are witness. And on earth, blood, water, and the Spirit, three witnesses. So it's a quorum witness. It's a corporate thing. Okay? So Bible says if two or three are gathered, this is not an individual situation. This is a body situation. A body of Christ situation. Because when two or three gathered, it's a church. It's a body of Christ. Okay? And also gather in the name. For where two or three gather in my name. So it's the gathering of two or three in the name of Jesus is where brings the authority. Are you with me? Okay, so first request, at least a minimum ceiling of witness must be satisfied. And the second request is gathered in the name of Christ. Okay, under the authority vested in the name of Jesus Christ. We are going somewhere. I want you to build it layer by layer. So don't lose me. Where is he going? What is he trying to say? Wait. Okay. So we are gathered here. Everything we do under the influence and authority of Christ. There is a level of authority available because we operate under the authority of Christ. So that's the church. When two or three gathered, it's a church. We use under the name of Christ. We operate under the name of Christ, and there is authority. There is protection. There is covering. Okay? So that's why it says, whatever you bind on earth, it will be bound in heaven. And whatever you loose on earth, it will be loosed in heaven. Again, truly I tell you that if two of you on earth agree about anything they ask for, it will be done for them by my Father in heaven. For there are two or three gather in my name, there I am with them. Okay, so verse 20 is the key to verse 19. Are you with me? So two or three operate under the authority, under cover of the name of Jesus. That's the church. we operate. Church is not a building, it's God's people coming together. Now, if myself, Sean, and Insta, we get together and start praying, we are a church. Okay? It's a called out group. It's ecclesia. It's a called out group. And we come under cover of the name of Jesus. There is a covering when you are a church. Okay? So now the presence of Christ can move through them, speak through them, intercede through them, use them as an extension of himself when you come under the name of Jesus. So church, when we come as a church, and when we come under the name of Jesus, and we operate under the name of Jesus, we can be influenced by the name of Jesus, and then we speak through him, and then we intercede through him, and we use, we are used as an extension of himself, because we are under cover of the name of Jesus. So there is a covering that is available and in existence as we come as a church. In the name of Jesus. Okay? So it is no longer what you want to do or I want to do, but Christ, what Christ wants to do. Because we are operating under the authority vested in the name of Jesus. Okay? At the mention of the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow down. Every tongue shall confess. So every knee bows down. So when we come as a corporate body of Christ and we operate together under the name of Jesus Christ, we come under the covering of the name of Jesus Christ. So we become the extension of his name. We become the voice of his name. Okay? So when you walk spiritually, blameless, upright, righteous, there is a covering because of the personal holiness. Walk with God. And then when we have come as a corporate body, okay, two or three, it's a corporate body. And when we come under the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, we come under the authority of the name, become his body, and then his name becomes, we come under cover of his name. So this is why being a part of a church is very important, precious child of God. You are walking with God personally, righteous and blameless. Yes, there is a dimension of covering. And then also when you come under the name of Jesus Christ, under a corporate body of Christ, then also you have a covering. Okay, I will show you. Now, let's go to 1 Corinthians chapter 5. I think, let's see if we have time. It's going to become a concern. 1 Corinthians chapter 5 verse 4. 1 Corinthians chapter 5 verse 4. So, when you are assembled, and I am with you in spirit, and the power of our Lord Jesus is present. Okay? So, Paul is writing to the Corinthian church, and he's saying, when you gather as a church, as the body of Christ, I am present with you in spirit. I'm writing you a letter from somewhere, but I'm present with you in spirit. And he's also saying, the power of our Lord Jesus is present. Okay? So, this is a corporate covering that we are talking about, a corporate undercover under the name of Jesus Christ when we come. Okay? So Paul says, when we gather in this manner, I am also present in the Spirit and the Lord also present. Now watch. Now I am coming to a very important thing. This is where I was building it. You know, this is where I came step by step to show you. This is where I wanted to come at. Now look, watch verse 5. Watch the verse 5. Hand this man over to Satan for the destruction of the flesh, so that his spirit may be saved on the day of the Lord. Okay? Now, Paul is writing, keep this scripture, Sean. Paul is writing to the church in Corinth. He's saying there is a man who is into fornication. Okay? He's saying, hand this man over to Satan. He's telling the church, hand this man over to Satan. That means this man is into fornication and he has removed his personal hedge. Get me, precious people of God. What is the primary hedge we saw? When you walk holy before God, what do you get? There are three-dimensional hedge. Am I right? Are you getting? Are you thinking? Are you seeing what I'm seeing? Job was walking blameless, upright, fearing God, eschewing evil. He had three-dimensional hedge. But when you don't walk in personal holiness, righteousness, you kind of create gaps in your hedge. Your hedge is infiltrated because of your unrighteous living. You have kind of lost your personal hedge. But what has happened is, this man is inside the church and church covering is there. Oh, I hope you're getting what I'm saying. And Paul is saying, take the church covering, hand this man over to Satan. Are you getting what I'm saying? Are you seeing what I'm seeing? I hope that you're seeing what I'm saying. Hand this man over to Satan. In other words, Paul is saying, take the church covering. The corporate covering that comes when people come together. Hand this man over to Satan for the destruction of the flesh, so that his spirit may be saved on the day of the Lord. So, precious children of God, how many edges were removed from Job? God gave permission to the second edge, but to see what happened. The devil has touched Job also. He is now, there are boils in his body. Okay? But watch here. The devil can touch his flesh, but not his life. He can't take his life. Okay? He can't take his life. He can touch his body and inflict sickness, but he has no authority to take his life. So Job's edge was, the primary edge was on his life. God said, you cannot take his life, but his flesh you can touch. So Paul is saying, this is what Paul is saying. He has lost his personal edge. This man, because of his fornication, let's read from verse 1 onwards. 1 Corinthians chapter 5 verse onwards. He was into incest. It is actually reported that there is a sexual immorality among you, and of a kind of that even pagans do not tolerate. A man is sleeping with his father's wife, and you are proud. Shouldn't you rather have gone into mourning and have put out of your fellowship the man who has been doing this? Put him out of the fellowship. For my part, even though I am not physically present, I am with you in spirit. As one who is present with you in this way, I have already passed judgment in the name of our Lord Jesus on the one who has been doing this. So when you are assembled, I am with you in spirit, and the power of the Lord Jesus is present. Verse 5. Hand this man over to Satan. How Paul is saying, hand this man over to Satan? Put him out of the fellowship so that he has lost his personal hedge because of unrighteous living. Now he's going to, when you put him out of the fellowship, he's going to lose the corporate hedge of the church. So he is exposed to Satan. But Paul is saying that he will only touch his flesh. Satan can bring destruction to his flesh so that his spirit may be saved. So when Satan touched Job, he touched his flesh, but not his life. That's what Paul is saying here also. Are you with me, precious child of God? So why I brought this story is how a church fellowship is important. How a church fellowship is important. Being in the fellowship of a church is itself is a covering, a spiritual undercover. That's what I wanted to get at. And I think I'll have to stop here because we've gone more than 1 hour. And we will take it forward from next week. And I hope that you are learning. I hope that you are seeing things what the way I'm seeing it. And may the Holy Spirit give you more revelation. May the Holy Spirit broaden your understanding more and teach you more than what I have taught you. So your personal edge is important because of your righteous walk. And number two, your corporate hedge through the church is important, because when we come together under the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, there is a corporate hedge, a corporate undercover, and then there is personal undercover. Amen. Let's pray. Father, we want to say thank you for teaching us truths, revealing us greater truths. We are so grateful to you, God. We are so thankful to you, God. Precious Lord, help us to always walk blameless, upright, in the fear of you, Lord, and shunning evil. Precious Lord, thank you for the hedge that you have placed around me, my family, and my possessions. Thank you for the corporate hedge undercover that I come because I'm part of a church. And Lord, even if my covering is taken to prove my capacity and my status, thank you, Lord, that you will not permit things beyond my capacity. And thank you, Lord, that you will give me the wisdom to show me a way out to endure it. I pray, Lord, that children who have walked blameless, righteous before you, who are undergoing trials, that I pray that they will triumph, God, through with their capacity. And I pray that they will position themselves for a promotion. Some of you going through trials, even though you have walked righteous, blameless, upright, you're positioning yourself for promotion. Stay in there. Fight a good fight of faith. Fight a good fight of patience, I would rather say. Prove your capacity before God. Your promotion is waiting. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Holy Spirit of God. I see a mother. I see a mother. Your daughters, your granddaughter is with you. Your daughter has gone abroad. She's divorced. Your daughter is divorced. She's gone abroad to work. And your granddaughter is with you. And dear grandmother, I would rather call you. You also working, but you're going through so much of trials. With this child with you, daughter away, you working. There are times you felt like saying, I can't anymore. I want to tell you, endure the season. God, you have walked upright before God. You are a righteous woman. You're a God-fearing woman. You have walked in the fear of the Lord. But you are cracking. But I would say the Lord will not test you beyond your capacity. You can endure this season. But I don't see you in a good fellowship, in a good church. I don't see you. You're a God-fearing person. You're a righteous person. But you are not a regular member of a church. You're not so established and grounded your footing in a good church. Do that. It's very important. Do that. It's very important. Prayerfully seek the Lord and find a good church and settle down. It's going to help you a lot to endure this season. And I'm telling you, the way out that God is showing you, the wisdom that is God is speaking to you in this trial time is finding a church and settling down. That is the way out that God is showing you. Catch it, my precious grandmother. You will overcome this season. I release this word to you. Precious Lord, thank you, Father, for what you're doing in our midst and what you're doing through these Bible studies. Thank you for the revelation. Thank you, for Lord, for the maturity of your children. Thank you for the grace that you have given us to do this Bible study Wednesdays and Fridays. And I bless, Lord, Sean and Insta who are here Fridays and Lord, Wednesdays to bring these Bible studies on. Yeah, I bless these children for their commitment, oh God. And Lord, I thank you for the facilities that we have. And I thank and I bless Timothy for all what we have to bring these studies to many people. Thank you, God, for this grace. And thank you for the good health and strength that you have given us, God. We bless you for all what you have done with the Father's House ministries and with us, God. We are ever grateful to you and thankful to you. And I thank you for all the faithful, consistent students who come to learn. Bless them, bless them, bless them, my Father. Oh, thank you, Lord. Right now, God's presence is with us. His power is present with us. His power to heal you is present. His power to deliver you is present. His power to rescue is present. Make use of it. Activate your faith. Demonstrate your faith and see how the power is present in that room where you are watching this Bible study. The power of God is present. Activate your faith. Demonstrate your faith. You will see the power manifest. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Father, for this privilege. We bless you. In Jesus' mighty name, we pray. And everyone say amen. God bless you. Have a blessed, blessed week. I hope that you're enjoying your holiday, New Year holiday in Sri Lanka. If you're watching us through from Sri Lanka. And next week, as I told you, there's no Wednesday and Friday Bible study. We will meet you week after. But I hope to see you all on Saturday fasting and prayer time. Hope to see you on Sunday. Sunday we have a surprise. We have a new preacher coming in to preach. So I want you to be in the house of God to listen to this preacher. You will be tremendously blessed. Amen. Tune in if you're on holiday somewhere. Tune in for the Sunday service. If you are in Colombo, please come for the service and be blessed. God bless you. We love you, Lords. And Jesus loves you.
This is how I fight my battle.